Hello, you're watching Proactive. I'm joined by Gavin Chamberlain, the CEO of Bannerman Energy. Gavin, very good to meet you.
Great. Morning, Stephen, and pleasure to meet you as well.
So Gavin, for viewers not familiar with the company, tell us more about Bannerman Energy.
Yeah, so Bannerman Energy has been around for about 14 years. We are a uranium development company, but only focused in Namibia at the moment. So we got our flagship project there, which is 8 million ton or 3.5 million pound uranium project that we published as a DFS in December 22 and are currently moving forward through the development phase.
So that's the Etango project in Namibia, as you mentioned. Tell us a bit about Namibia as a mining jurisdiction.
Yeah, I think, Stephen, that's probably one of the biggest pluses we have. Namibia has been exporting uranium around the world to all jurisdictions for over 45 years. So the original Rossing mine has been there and operating for close on 48 years. And then there's two other producers in country at the moment. So we have the Husap mine, which is a large Chinese-owned uranium project, well, company, I should say. And then just recently, Paladin managed to restart their mine as well. And then there's a couple of junior miners and ourselves sort of been there for over 14 years now. The jurisdiction is as I said, very mature. So the knowledge around uranium in Namibia is fantastic. The support from the government, the regulatory support in terms of radiation control and export is also fantastic. So we've got a really strong backing. And over and above that is, for projects in Africa, normally one of your biggest expenses is infrastructure. In this particular case, we've got a road that takes us to within 7 kilometers of the mine. So we only have an access road of 7 kilometers to build. We have a mature water and power infrastructure around us. So once again, we can physically get power and water to the site with relative ease. And then over and above that is we're only 35 kilometers from the Walvis Bay port where we export our, well, we will export our uranium from. So once again, a very positive situation for an African country. If you have to compare it to most other African countries, you spend a lot more money and time on building infrastructure.
And Gavin, you recently completed a scoping study evaluating higher future throughput or operating life for the mine. Take us through that and the options you're considering.
Yeah, definitely. I think before I even start on that, I do need to emphasize that our focus is on building the Etango 8 million ton first and foremost. So the options that we evaluated are really around, we've got a very large resource, but we're only using 60 million of a 220 million resource in our Etango 8 project. So obviously we wanted to know what the future of the mine would look like. And we approached that by doing a scoping study, looking at both extending the capacity from 8 million tons to 16 million tons, or basically taking it from 3.5 million pounds of uranium up to 6.7 million pounds of uranium. But we would only do that probably in year 5 of the operation. So we would have got the original project into operations, paid off the debt, and then effectively reinvest some capital to expand the project, at least the capacity of the project. So that's what we have referred to as XP, in other words, the expansion case. The expansion case is really attractive if the uranium price continues to rise, because then that means in 5 years' time, we have basically 8 million tons of uranium, which is uncontracted. So effectively, we could contract it at higher uranium prices, which is obviously a major plus for a project of this nature. The extension case, though, is more for where the uranium price stays pretty consistent and doesn't continue to climb. And there we've just looked at extending the life of mine. So hence XT, extension case. And that extends the life of mine from 15 to 27 years with no real input of capital apart from a little bit of pre-strip and an increased sustaining capital to look at the maintenance of the plant. And that's a very attractive option in terms of if the uranium price stays pretty steady, we just continue doing what we're doing, but doing it for a much longer period of time. So we really wanted to, we've been talking about the fact this project is scalable and we wanted to put some numbers to it so we could actually let people understand how scalable it really is. So we've looked at both options and they're at a scoping study level, but with the maturity of the information available to us, we probably can take it from a scoping study to a DFS probably in 6 to 9 months. So we're under no time pressure to make any decisions around which expansion case we decide to run with. So it was really give parity to the market more than anything else.
Gavin, the earlier phases of the project, when would you expect to progress with those and actually get uranium out of the ground?
Yeah, so we're in funding phase at the moment. So we're in a fairly enviable position from a junior miner's perspective in that we got a fair amount of cash in the bank. We spent the whole of 2023 doing front-end engineering design with our consultants who have both been on the project for a number of years. So what we've done there is we've fine-tuned a whole lot of the upfront work, and we've actually gone out to tender on a lot of the contracts as well, and actually placed 9 of the initial crushing contract orders. So that's just a secure vendor drawing so we can get detailed design done. And we've also we got our mining license in December last year. So we're now fully permitted. We have all our environmental permits as well as our mining license. And the day after we got the mining license, we issued the construction contracts for the construction water and the access road. So those two contracts are currently running, which are putting us in a position that will allow us to start construction as soon as we solve the funding equation. And we're busy with the funding equation on a number of fronts. So the main front being we're running a strategic financing process right now, which really picked up momentum this year after the award of the mining license in December last year. And at the same time, we're also talking to utilities around potentially getting some offtake contracts in place. And 2 years ago, we actually did a whole lot of work on debt funding. So we've made sure that we're ready. If we have to go with the debt funding route, we have done like third-party reviews of the ESIA, and we're basically in a position that we know we'll be able to meet most debt providers' requirements in terms of technical and due diligence.
Gavin, you were talking about the uranium price, and we have seen a recovery. How do you see the market dynamics at the moment, and where do you see the price going?
Yeah, well, I mean, the spike in December was obviously extremely exciting for a lot of people, but I think a lot of profit taking probably was at the back of that. We saw it settle down to 80, and it slowly climbed up and it's back at 90 at the moment. We see the uranium price basically continuing to increase in price, and it's really driven by market conditions more than anything else. Is the supply and demand curve shows that we're starting to get a gap between supply and demand. For a number of years post Fukushima, the uranium price obviously plummeted, but manufacturers or uranium producers continued to produce, and a lot of people stockpiled product. So that stockpiled product has now been used up, and we're back into a straight supply demand curve. And the demand curve has grown significantly. So we believe that the fundamentals behind the uranium price increase are still pretty sound. So we're expecting the price to continue to climb.
And Gavin, the sort of milestones your investors should be looking out for in the short to the medium term?
I think the first milestone hopefully will be the finalization of the strategic financing, because on the back of that, we'll be able to tell the market pretty clearly in terms of what the final part of the financing solution is. And I think the next sort of physical milestone would be the completion of the access road and water contracts, which we expect in June.
Well, Gavin, I hope you'll keep us posted on any progress. Thank you very much for the introduction today.
Excellent. Thank you very much for your time.
That's Gavin Chamberlain, the CEO of Bannerman Energy.